published 1700 Eastern Standard Time, the 12th of February 2018, updated 906 Eastern Standard Time, the 13th of February 2018. Ayia Napa in the summer of 2000 was football's height of excess. It was a holiday where all sense of restraint was absent. It felt like every Premier League player who hadn't made the Euros was in Ayia Napa that summer. Aside from me and Rio Ferdinand, there was Michael Dewberry, Jody Morris, Frank Lampard, Robbie Keane, Jonathan Woodgate, Andy Myers, Paolo Vanazza, Ashley Cole and Titus Bramble, and that was just the group one hung around with. I was left out of the England squad for Euro 2000 by Kevin Keegan, so went to Ayia Napa. The first 2 years I had been to Ayia Napa, I was an Ipswich player and no one recognised me. There were so many of us that one afternoon we decided to have an 11-a-side on the beach. It was like a Premier League game and the whole beach stopped to watch. Footballers were still coming to terms with the fact that their wealth set them apart. Before, English footballers didn't have that level of celebrity or disposable income. Later, the popularity of camera phones and the advent of Facebook and Twitter meant players simply couldn't get away with behaving like that anymore. The first 2 years I had been to Ayia Napa, I was an Ipswich player and no one really recognised me. When I went with Rio, it was different. Suddenly, I was a Premier League and England player and everyone wanted a piece of me. I loved it. I got off on it. It was a real buzz. We were young boys with no ties and I loved the idea that everybody was craving my company. I didn't think about the reasons why they wanted to have a drink with me or come back to my room. I was a kid. I was having a good time. It was a time of excess and I didn't know how to deal with it. It didn't occur to me that I was being irresponsible or ruining things for others. I had money and fame and was drunk on both. It went to my head. It was part of growing up. I don't regret that. I think there was a general feeling that we could do anything we wanted. We didn't have to play by the rules that society abided by and so we cut loose. It was a dangerous feeling. You behaved badly and nobody told you not to. Everybody wanted us in their bar or club and so we were indulged whatever we did, however we dressed, however we behaved. When you're a young footballer no one ever seems to say no. We'd roll into a nightclub straight off the beach, sweaty and sandy, in a vest and shorts, and they'd let us straight in. It was a different case when I turned up with Rio Ferdinand and Frank Lampard in 2000. Suddenly, I was a Premier League and England player and everyone wanted a piece of me. Adapted from Old Too Soon, Smart Too Late by Kieron Dyer. With Oliver Holt, published on February 22 by Headline at £20, to order a copy for £16, offer valid to the 18th of February 21, p. We were kids whose egos were out of control, discovering that in the age of celebrity, some people would do almost anything to be with you. I was not unnerved by that. I was intoxicated by it. When we saw how big we were and realized the level of fame I attached to being a Premier League footballer, we thought we were above the law and nothing was going to stop us having a good time. The amount we drank, it was absolute carnage. I was a young, single man and I had girls throwing themselves at me. We could have slept with 3 girls a day if we wanted to. I played the field in Ayia Napa. I wasn't as prolific as some of the lads, mainly because I was too p**. I was so wasted one night, I slept through one of England's matches. We played a game where you had to stay awake for 24 hours and one day the lads put a shot of tequila on every single bin on the beach for 500 meters, so 10 bins, 10 shots of tequila. You had to sprint to the first bin, gulp down the shot, sprint back. Then sprint to the second bin, down the shot, sprint back, and so on. Runs, drink, runs, repeat. Once, I tried to hurdle a sun lounger, hit the top of it and went sprawling face down in the sand. I was so wasted one night, I slept through one of England's group matches at Euro 2000. There we were in 30 degrees heat, sprinting up and down a public beach, necking shots and having a laugh. After our first day, there were some pictures printed in one of the papers back home with a headline, Animals. But you know what? We didn't give a**. It was the end of the season and we thought we were invincible. Being called animals in the press ought to have curbed our enthusiasm, but we just carried on. We knew there were cameras around and we knew reporters were following us. We didn't care. They printed one picture of me on the back of a moped with Rio. That was astonishingly tame compared to the rest of the stuff we got up to, but it got me in trouble, because my contract said something about not riding motorbikes. Rio brought some friends with him and they were in charge of the camcorder. They filmed everything. One night I was having sex when one of Rio's pals came into the room and started filming us on the group camcorder. I hadn't set it up and it wasn't done with my consent. When we realized, I jumped off the girl and told the guy to get lost. It was completely wrong. The girl was mortified. I apologized profusely and took her to get a taxi back to her hotel. There was another night when Rio and Frank and a couple of others took some girls back to their room. The girls knew there was a camera filming and they were up for it. They were all filmed having sex in the room. I'm certainly not trying to portray myself as an innocent party. I was having a good time. My actions didn't show a lot of respect to the woman involved, but I wasn't complicit in secretly filming her. Nor did Frank and Rio secretly film anyone. No one was tricked into anything they didn't want to do. I was filmed on the back of a motorbike with Rio. It was relatively tame, but I got in trouble for it. That camcorder was always around. Every morning would look at the footage from the night before. It was usually people dancing, chatting up girls, being stupid. There were other people around, hangers-on, people on the periphery, friends of friends who weren't really friends at all, and they knew there was lively stuff on the tape. One day, whoever was in charge of the camcorder was attacked. He was followed and somebody put a knife to his throat and said, "Give us the camera." He handed it over. I flew home none the wiser and got back to Ipswich on Friday lunchtime. I met up with some friends and went on an all-day session. We went to a club in town and one of my mates got into an argument. I jumped in, thinking I was the king of something or other, and the guy smashed me in the eye. I went to hospital and had to have tests to check whether my vision had been permanently damaged. On Sunday, I asked my mum to get me a paper to see what they had said about the fight. She had a face like thunder when she got back and threw a copy of the News of the World at me. "You're an embarrassment," she said. I stared at the front page and suddenly everything became clear. The paper had got footage of some of the sex sessions in Ayia Napa, including where the guy sneaked into my room. "England stars in video sex shame," the headline said. It was spun that the girls had been duped into being filmed when actually, in the case of the girls who got together with Frank and Rio, it had been done with their consent. I would never deny that the way I behaved wasn't exactly ideal. I wasn't proud of it. The paper had footage of a sex session in Ayia Napa, including the guy sneaking into my room. He was smart too late. I was 28 and started to get a sense that football wasn't going to last forever. You look at some of our great players like Frank Lampard, Jamie Carragher and Steven Gerrard, they all had wild moments in their youth but matured and their careers flourished through hard work and talent, and everyone forgot about what they had done when they were kids. I wanted a bit of that, too. The process of change had begun in my last couple of years at Newcastle. I very rarely went out. I still had a couple of drinks now and again, but crucially I stopped getting drunk. Going out wasn't fun anymore. I just changed. I wanted to dedicate everything to football. I was the first into training and last to leave. I ate healthily and was more careful about nutrition. I became a model professional. I went from being one of the least professional players to one of the most diligent and conscientious. I did everything I could to give myself every chance of being the best I could be. Finally, I got smart. It wasn't until my final 2 years as a Newcastle player that I finally grew up and knuckled down. I wasn't interested in glitz. I didn't want to be known as the bling boy or the brat anymore. I just wanted to get my head down, play and lose some of the negativity that infected people's views of me. I'd brought a lot of that on myself and I wanted to try to undo some of it. I have a few regrets about my career. I wish I had looked after myself more when I was younger. I had a great time, but it cost me. I was regarded as one of the outstanding talents of my generation when I was a young player, but I didn't have the career that Gerrard, Lampard and Rio Ferdinand did. Not even close. By the time I realized I needed to look after myself better, the damage had been done to my body. So even though I became the model professional, the sins of my previous existence and bad luck made me pay. Whenever I met up with England, the boys asked me questions about Cheryl. Ashley Cole asked a million and one questions. He was fascinated by her. When they got together and married, it all started to make sense. He was always keen on her and desperate to get to know her. 6 months or so after we stopped seeing each other, I read stories about how she was going out with him. Ashley Cole asked him 1,001 questions about Cheryl. He was fascinated by her. Ashley and I had been really close until then, and would go out in London all the time. After he started going out with Cheryl, we would text and talk, but we were never close friends again. Me and Cheryl had hit it off straight away. We went to the cinema for our first date and she admitted she'd had a few drinks to calm her nerves. She was so nervous. She was an absolutely great girl, but my personal life was complicated at that time and I wouldn't say we were ever really boyfriend and girlfriend. There was a time a bit later when she wanted me to get more serious, but I couldn't because I had got another girl pregnant and I could never have got serious with Cheryl knowing that I was about to have a child with someone else. I would have liked to get more serious, but I knew I had to deal with the fact I was going to become a father again. I knew that Cheryl deserved better than me, so it kind of fizzled out. I just wasn't a good fit for her, because I couldn't commit to her. There were trust issues as well. She wanted more and I couldn't give her any more. Nothing will ever change my mind that she's a great person, though. When my sister was sent to prison, 5 years after we stopped seeing each other, Cheryl sent a big bunch of flowers and a card to my mum. I have no idea how she got hold of mum's address, but that just emphasized to me what a great heart she has. 6 months or so after I stopped seeing her, I read about how she was going out with pimp money footballers and can be a shock to the system. So when I got money, I wanted to indulge myself and my friends. In the late 1990s, Gucci made a watch with a big G emblazoned on it. I loved it. It cost £900 and it felt amazing to be able to afford that. A few months later, I bought 3 of my best friends' G watch for Christmas. I'm never tired of being able to give things to people. I took 20 of us to Barbados once and 15 to Dubai, all in business class. I was in a position to do that and it gave me a lot of pleasure, so why not? There is no better feeling than seeing people, who are usually at the back of the plane, finally getting on the beds in business class. Things like that give me such a buzz. People called me the king of bling later in my career, but that's okay. I wouldn't change that. I would have still bought my expensive watches. My childhood had been poor and I wanted to catch up. Why couldn't I enjoy myself? Why couldn't I treat myself? My Ferrari F360 Modena was an incredible thrill and I drove it around town any chance I could. I had two big dreams when I was a kid. One was playing for England. The other was owning a Ferrari. I'd achieved the first one, so when I got back from the 2002 World Cup, I treated myself to a new car. I went to a fancy dealership in Newcastle, ordered a bright red Ferrari F360 Modena and paid £120,000. It was an incredible thrill. It was a symbol of youth and wealth, of power and arrival. I drove it everywhere. I drove to training in it. I drove it down to the quayside when going out clubbing. I went to the shops in it. I laugh now about how conspicuous I must have been, but I didn't think about that then. I must have stuck out like a sore thumb driving around a goldfish bowl like Newcastle. They saw that car coming and thought, here's Kieron Dyer. There were some things about the Ferrari that I didn't enjoy. There was no comfort. You were so low down that you felt every bump, and I nearly lost the back end a couple of times when I was going round corners. There was so much power in it and so much acceleration that it was ill-suited to city driving. It was absolutely pointless having it in Newcastle, really, certainly from a practical point of view. But I didn't really do practical back then. But who thinks with common sense when you are a 23-year-old behind the wheel of your first Ferrari? It had raw power, so who cares if it was a bumpy ride? It was rapid, that was the main thing. The repairs to the Ferrari cost about £45,000 and I got rid of it as soon as it was fixed. He had been in a nightclub for a few hours when my mate Curtis asked if I'd take him out for a couple of circuits of the city in the Ferrari. It was around 1 a.m. by that stage, but like a moron, I said I would. Curtis was buzzing about being in the car, so I wanted to give him a decent spin. It was tricky to get speed up in the city because the streets are tight with lots of bends, but the acceleration still pinned him back in his seat with that V8 engine roaring away. What a goon I must have looked. Soon enough, I came flying around a corner and the back end got away from me and started spinning. It seemed to be spinning for an eternity and I waited for the inevitable. I braced myself and then smashed into the barriers. It kept spinning and smashing everything in its path. All the airbags popped before the Ferrari came to a halt. The bridge would crash on was right in the center of Newcastle's nightlife area, and loads of people were on the scene quickly. Some recognized me straight away and urged me to flee the scene. Runs, they were saying. I think they assumed I was drunk, because they said they'd take the rap for me. That's how loyal Geordies are, they would do anything for their team. The repairs cost about £45,000 and I had to suck it up. I got rid of that car as soon as it was fixed, adapted from old too soon, smart too late. My story by Kieron Dyer with Oliver Holt, published on February 22nd by Headline at £20. To order a copy for £16, offer valid to the 18th of February 21, p.